Ellen, most recently, the United States, Japan, and India have asked OPEC Plus to increase production. Saudi Arabia and Russia, who are part of that group, have essentially dismissed that request. Tell us about what happens now. We're heading into the winter months. We see what's happening in Europe with respect to a natural gas shortage. What are we looking at?
In terms of the United States, we're definitely looking at a period of higher electricity prices and heating prices. Typically in the United States, we do see a seasonal pattern where prices do tend to drop during the winter and rise during the summer. But what we're seeing now is actually a dislocation of that traditional pattern where prices are not dropping in the winter. And in fact, they're looking to rise. So this could definitely pose some fairly significant challenges to people, consumers, customers who are still looking to make ends meet and are suddenly going to find themselves with more expensive electricity bills, even if this winter isn't especially cold. We've heard a lot about how if the winter is especially cold, things could get tight. But in this instance, supply will probably still be fine if the winter isn't particularly cold, but prices will still go up.
So who comes to the rescue here? Is it OPEC? Is it the petroleum reserve? Who steps in here?
Well, when it comes to electricity prices, there really isn't much that OPEC can do because a lot of the electricity in the United States in particular is produced from natural gas. And a lot of that is domestically produced. And OPEC doesn't really have much of an impact on that. In fact, OPEC is actually been following a prescribed plan where they're increasing their oil production by about 400,000 barrels a day each month. And by the time we hit May, June, they'll have put most of the production that they took offline during the height of the pandemic back online. So when the Biden administration and Japan and India say they want OPEC to produce more, what they're really saying is, we want you to produce more now. We want you to actually flood the market with oil to bring prices down. And OPEC is saying, we are producing more. We're just doing it in a more gradual way because we don't want to flood the market. And so this is where I think the disconnect in terms of consuming nations and producing nations is. But keep in mind, the US is also a producing nation. So is Canada. So it's not that OPEC is the only source of petroleum to alleviate high gasoline prices. It's just that they've become the focus of certain consuming nations.
Is it interesting to you that the Biden administration is curbing domestic oil and gas production? And you also had mentioned Canada. There would be an option here for the Biden administration to turn to Canada here.
Exactly. In fact, Canada is the largest source of oil imports for the United States right now. Second happens to be Saudi Arabia, but Canada is far and above that. And so really, when you look at the North American oil ecosystem, the United States and Canada are very much intertwined. And so it would only make sense to increase that interconnectedness and to look, say, to Canada to potentially supply more oil, particularly, in fact, Western Canadian Select blends, which are a heavier blend of oil, is something that the United States needs more of because U.S. Producers mostly produce a very light kind of oil. And Western Canadian Select is actually not as nearly as expensive as other blends of oil. So there's definitely a lot more that could be done in terms of cross-border cooperation to alleviate some of the high gasoline prices. But at the same time, the Biden administration doesn't seem to be working very much to encourage American producers to increase their production. And U.S. production is actually down about 1.6 million barrels a day from where it could be. And so that's a fairly large discrepancy there. And it does seem that a lot of producers are very hesitant to increase production because they're getting a lot of pressure from their shareholders not to spend more money at all. But at the same time, there are definitely political forces at play here that are making producers wary to expand drilling right now.
The fate of Line 5 still hangs in the balance. The Biden administration recently saying that they are willing to negotiate. But when you take a look at that bigger picture with respect to curbing domestic production in the U.S. and Line 5, ultimately, where are the U.S. president's energy policies headed? Where is he going?
This is a really, really good question, because it almost seems like the Biden administration doesn't really have a set energy policy. They don't really have a good picture of where they want things to go. They clearly think that prices are too high for consumers, but they really don't have a good sense of what they can do to change that, what they can do to alleviate that. They've thrown out policy recommendations like doing a release from the Strategic Petroleum Reserve, but that's really only a very short-term measure. It wouldn't have a kind of systemic effect that's needed. They've talked about banning crude oil exports again, which is something that would be really disastrous and would probably have the opposite effect. One of the things, though, that I think would be very important to keeping prices down, or at least preventing them from rising more, would be to make sure that Line 5 remains operational between Canada and the United States, because shutting that down would just exacerbate the problem even more, particularly when it comes to petroleum products like propane. That line carries a lot of propane to the Midwest, and a lot of people in the Midwest use propane for heating their homes. They need it for things like poultry farming. And if that were to get shut down, it would really be devastating economically for that region. So I would say keeping Line 5 open would be, or should be, a priority if the Biden administration wants to, at the very least, curb rising prices. Even if they can't do anything to bring them down, that would certainly provide some security in terms of what's going to happen moving forward with prices.
COP26, the global summit set to wrap up shortly, but the COP president recently said that contentious differences remain. Is there a disconnect between what the summit is hoping to set out to do and what is actually happening on the ground with respect to the demand for fossil fuels?
Yeah, absolutely. I think that the current energy crisis really brings home this disconnect in a very real way, because you have a summit where basically a portion of the people and the delegates there really want to see commitments to ending the use of fossil fuels entirely. And then you have a portion of people who are saying, hold on, take a step back. You know, that's just not feasible. We really, if we want to reduce emissions, we should concentrate more on having cleaner, greener fossil fuel use. But just saying that we need to cut the use of fossil fuels altogether is just unrealistic, and it's not going to happen. And I think that's really where the fundamental disconnect is. Now, can they find common ground in terms of reducing fossil fuel use, not ending it, realizing that it is still a vital source of energy for everyone in the entire world, but also particularly for developing countries, but also finding ways to utilize these sources in cleaner ways? That really seems to be the challenge. And I'm not sure that they're really bridging that gap all that effectively at this conference.